friends, and welcome to Zion's United Church of Christ of Caverton in Sand Lake, New York. Those of you who are worshiping with us for the first time, we're glad that you're here. And if you would like to get a copy of our worship bulletin and or just generally know what's going on at our church, please give us an email at ZionTabertonChurch@gmail.com. And then follow along on our website, TabertonChurch.org. And there you'll be able to know, see who we are and what we believe and what we're about, what we aspire to, and also be able to follow us on our weekly services. Those of you who are old-timers, constant members of our congregation, we're glad that you're here too, and particularly on this Memorial Day Decoration Day. We know that a number of you are veterans, but we offer our thanks to your service, and then we also, for today, look back and remember those whose lives were lost during previous wars. I also like to invite all of you to join us for Zoom, for coffee hour in Zoom. On the bulletin, there is the meeting number, but if you don't have our bulletin, the meeting ID, and we're brave people here, is 828-5638-1018. 528-5638-1018. And there is no password, so we ask that you come one and all. It will be good to see your faces and hear your voices after being a whole week away from each other. And with that, let us, oh, I forgot one other thing. Katie O'Neill is joining our music staff this summer, as she has done in the past. So let's all give Katie a round of applause. And thanks for being with us. And let us make time for a prayer for peace. Let's pray. Gracious God of the nations, gracious God of love and peace and justice and compassion, with joy we come to this church, we gather together as a people of faith to say thank you for all that you have done, from carrying us from one week into another. Thank you for the provision of food and home and friends and all of the things that we need to keep ourselves alive, to be reminded that you are ever present with us. So as we rejoice with others who have what we need and enjoy a modicum of freedom and stability, we pray for a peace in places where that is not the case, where there is strife, where there is not a stability that needs to be, that makes for human flourishing. So we gather up our own joy and we pair them with those who struggle and who fight for their own peace. May peace reign in our own hearts, in our own homes, and also around the world. We ask this in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus of Nazareth. Amen. Will you also join me in our responsive call to worship? This place for us is holy ground, the place where we sing songs of praise to God and repeat the stories of faith that inspire us to respond to Christ's love. God called us here in worship, in whispering winds and in burning flames, and by the Holy Spirit, God disarms us of the barriers we have placed around us. In our times of strength as well as despair, God meets us in our vulnerability and accompanies us until we are home. Friends, let us worship God. Our first hymn of the morning is, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Please join us as we raise our voices together.
Oh,
our praying and our singing are just one part of who we are as we gather. We have, like I said, passed from one week to another, having undergone all kinds of joys and trials and struggles, but also found our place, ourselves in places that we would rather not be, places in our hearts and in our heads. So, friends, let us join together in our unison opening prayer. O Lord, your love, justice, and you establish peace on earth. We bring before you the disunity of today's world, the absurd violence, and the many wars which are breaking the courage of the peoples of the world, human greed and injustice, which breeds hatred and strife. Send your spirit and renew the face of the earth. Teach us to be compassionate towards the whole human family. Strengthen the will of all those who fight for justice and for peace, and give us that peace which the world cannot take away or give. And now, O God, hear our private confessions we lift up to you now in silence. Friends of God, believe the good news. The steadfast love of the Lord never, ever ceases. God's love will never come to an end for us. God is always in pursuit of us. God will find us and love us. Friends, believe the good news. We are always already loved and wanted by God. Please join us as we sing the Gloria. Now, when I say armed forces, you may think of guns, and you may think of other kinds of things that people in the military fight with, but I want to let you know that there are soldiers who are they work in offices, and there are some who are mechanics and firefighters and all kinds of things, you name it, those people are in the armed forces. There are many, many jobs in the armed forces. So as you are enjoying your picnic and as you are outside enjoying the warm air, remember those who have fought and remember those who have died and how they did all of those things to keep us safe. Your parents keep you safe. Your teachers keep you safe. Your friends and families keep you safe. And the military also keeps you safe. So the next time you see someone in uniform, say thank you. Thank you for their service. Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you for so many people who do so many things to keep us alive and keep us safe. Help us always to be thankful. Amen. Now this is a time where all of us can give. We can give in so many ways, through our helping hands, through our money, through calls, through cards, and even visits over the back fence. I've had a couple of visits over my back fence here at the parsonage. So as you have made up your mind in advance to offer your gifts of time, talent, or finances, please bring them forward and we will join in singing the doxology. Gracious God, we turn to you this day full of all kinds of beautifulness, birds and bees and sunshine and grass and flowers and the anticipation of meeting and picnicking with friends and all of the joy and healing that that can bring to our hearts, particularly at a time when we need to distance from each other. Physically, but never ever in our hearts and in our sympathy with everyone. So as we look to this day. We also look to you and give thanks for how you have carried us through 1 week to the next and all of the things that our calendars say that we must do or can do or should do. We ask your grace and mercy as we try to live into them and to be and do our best to do those things that are needful, that help ourselves and help one another most of all. Open our eyes to those around us who may not say that they need help, but they do. Help us to be mindful to pray for those who are looking towards travel or visitors, looking for good news, or trying to figure out what they need to do because of the not so good news that they have received. We also pray for families whose lives have been upended because of this coronavirus. And we give you praise for those who are returning to work. Their jobs were saved and their employers are finding ways to bring them back to work in safety. So as we all venture out, or some of us venture out into the world that we knew, that we left, help us to be mindful. Help us to be compassionate. Help us not to live into the smallness of our own selves, of not believing or discounting, thinking that we have to choose between science and safety and our own freedom. Help us to have big hearts, to care for each other's safety as well as our own. And God, where there is the virus raging in other countries around the world, particularly in Brazil and in parts of Asia, and even in Africa that's not been so much talked about, we ask for your mercy. We ask for doctors and nurses to come alongside those people in those places where it's raging so, and the resources that we have here in the States is not so readily available. And we also pray for folk who are impacted in so many other ways besides the virus, of constantly being without food or safety or home, plagued by other diseases, by regimes that are relentless in pulling back and withholding and pressing down freedoms and the will to thrive and live. So that we bring all of these things, all of everything that we find great joy and take pleasure in, we bring those to you and say thank you. And we bring all of our concerns, the ones that are voiced in our own hearts, through our own lips, and the ones that we hide in our own hearts. We take pleasure and we know that you hear them all better than we can say them or even recount them in our own private time of prayer. So Lord, as you will, through our own hands and our own feet and our own voices, may your will be done. And help us always to pray the prayer that your Son taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. There are two scripture passages I have for us to share this morning. The first is from the book of Revelation, specifically from chapter 14, verse 13. And then also from Isaiah chapter 2, verse 4. Listen to God's words to us from the book of the Revelation. And I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, blessed are the dead who now die in the Lord. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them. And again from Isaiah, God will judge between the nations and render decisions for many countries. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. One nation will not raise the sword against another, and never again will they train for war. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. For those of you who have never been to our church, there are 127 white Memorial Day crosses on our front lawn. The majority of them bear the names of men and women who died while in the U.S. Armed Forces. Others bear the name of individuals who simply left a legacy of love to their family and friends. All of them bear a bouquet of flowers. But for those who served in the military, there is an American flag to signify the country where their hearts were. This is a tribute that our congregation has taken up for I don't know how many years. Maybe those of you who know can let me in on that. Those 127 crosses on our front lawn are small in comparison to the 400,000 plus crosses that are at Arlington Cemetery in Virginia. And it's a still smaller number of those that are in the 147 national cemeteries around the country. Still, they are no less significant. Each one is a fitting reminder of a life lost, a life given in response to causes that rival the value of their own life. We know the names of many of these war dead, and others we don't. We can only guess that some died with utter courage, others with questions and doubts, and maybe others in blinding fear. But regardless of their state of heart or mind, our privilege, our task today is to honor what they did by serving. The faithfulness of living into their task, and then everything in them that was good and kind and loving. For what else is there to do on any day? So today, this weekend, we give honor where honor is due. We hold in our individual and collective memories the men and women who answered the draft, who enlisted maybe, who trained and even then walked into the chaos and evil that is war. For they are and remain the beloved children of God. And as much as we honor and celebrate them, we have our own conflicts and wars to fight. I speak of the ones raging in our hearts and our heads that, when fed, can escalate into hate, setting up us to become the aggressor, where we maim and kill with our words and our actions. And those are real. As the over 1.3 million war dead, and that number is inclusive of all conflicts and wars since 1775 to the very present, as these war dead have ceased from their labors, of training for war and waging war, so too must we cease from our labors of war. We must desperately cease from thoughts and prejudices and ways of seeing that cause us to objectify others and project on them our shadows and regrets and fears and privations. Our task is to cease from centering our own views and perspectives in public and in private when the issue at hand throws all of our lives into turmoil. It's not easy, I know it's not. Our world is full of so much difference that our first reaction always seems to be to insist that our way, our perspective, is the most reasonable, the absolute appropriate task, measure to take. This is the stuff that wars are made of. This is the stuff, the thinking and feeling, where other bodies, human bodies, are sacrificed. In his book, Markings, Dag Hammarskjöld, the second Secretary General of the United Nations, wrote, "The longest journey is the journey inward." And if we are all honest with ourselves and one another, we all need to be further along on that journey, the inward journey, than we are. Friends, we have to refuse to not take up that journey. For when we refuse to embark upon the inward journey to do the work of introspection and recognize that often our own heart vision is short-sighted, when we refuse to take on that journey, we become broken and separated and immune from all of the people and situations that produce life. The sum of the gospel of Jesus Christ is reconciliation from beginning to end. And indeed, the entire activity of God from the beginning of time until whenever it ends for you and me is to bring together that which is broken and alienated and torn asunder. And this includes people and nations, and homes, and human hearts like yours and mine. The gospel is about cultivation, about planting, bringing things to life, and weeding out things that choke out life. This is what the writer of 1st Isaiah was speaking to when he talks about turning swords into plowshares and spears into pruning hooks. You can't grow anything when you have a sword and a spear in your hand. And you can't do anything with them as far as farming or bringing any delicate thing into life. In closing, Omar Nelson Bradley, General of the Army, a five-star general, and the first chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, is credited with saying, "The business of the church, its job, is to make the business of war impossible." I'll say it again. The business of the church, and I would even say by extension, the business of any person, kind-hearted, caring, compassionate person of any faith tradition, of any spirituality, their job is to make war impossible. And that starts with tending to the wars, tamping them out, extinguishing them in our own hearts. This Memorial Day and all the memorial days to follow, may we, the church, join time with people of good faith and conscience, to cease from our own labors of war, and do the harder work, the more gratifying work of peacemaking, if not for ourselves, then for the generations to follow us. May it be so for you, and may it be so for me. Amen. And let us pray. Gracious God, may the words of Scripture burn deeply in our hearts so that we may do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. Amen. Our final hymn of the morning is This Is My Song. The hymn tune is familiar, and hopefully the words are too. Let's sing together. Always. And the people of God said, Amen. Go in peace.